great to see all of you. I'm very excited to share this program with you. This program for me represents Vienna at the turn of the century. So if you look at your program, all three composers tonight were basically contemporaries, almost exact contemporaries. We're actually going in reverse chronological order. We're starting with Alban Berg, making our way back with Simlinsky, and then all the way back to Strauss. I think that you'll see that all three of them, though they were living at the same time, have very different styles and represent very much a turning point in musical development from what we know as a classical romantic repertoire that a lot of us spend a lot of time in to what can be generally termed the music of the future, something different. So a little bit about the sonata. I think it represents very well this melding of the music of the past and the music of the future. Let me give you two ways in which it's representative of the music of the past and two ways in which it's forward-looking. The first way it is representative of the past is that it's a sonata. It's a very old form, and it follows the conventions of form in that it has an exposition, and it has a repeat sign just as Beethoven would have put in, so you'll hear that. It has a development where all the themes are shaken and stirred and mixed up and expanded, and then there's a recapitulation where the original themes come back. It's also entirely in 3/4 meter. There are no shifting meters. There is a steady 3 beat. It may speed up, it may slow down, but it's always there. The ways in which it is more forward-looking are two as well. One is that it doesn't have a tonal center. It's not in E major, it's not in C minor, it's not really in a key. It flirts with B minor in the beginning, it ends in B minor, and in the middle, good luck finding a key. It makes great use of chromaticism. So in that sense, the whole point is that it doesn't really settle anywhere. And then the last point, and probably the most interesting way in which Berg's composition was forward-looking is the way it's constructed. So the entire sonata is woven from these motifs that come in the very first measure. And everything generates from that, like an acorn, or like building blocks, or like Tetris block, whatever you want to think of. And I'll play them for you. There are three main themes from which the entire piece springs. The first theme is the three-note motive. So that would be... And keep in mind that this theme can be inverted. It can be linked together to make a six-note theme. He changes it in a myriad of ways. The second theme is what I call the falling motive. So that would be the... It's usually looped in groups of twos like that. You'll hear that a lot. And the last theme is actually a rhythmic motive. It's a dotted rhythm motive. And these three are pervasive throughout the entire sonata. If you hear something that sounds kind of like those three, you probably have heard something that is generated by one of those motives. This is one of the tightest pieces of music ever written. Berg went over it measure by measure with his composition teacher, Arnold Schoenberg. And so this is not a toss-off piece. This is something that he labored over and thought about in terms of his new style for quite a while. So I hope you enjoy it.